All right, friends, welcome back. You've asked for it. We're listening. You have been requesting lots of fresh jelly content, so that's what we're going to bring you today. And I am not talking about the kind you eat with peanut butter. I am talking about the tentacled kind. And I am standing here with my lovely friend, Julie. Julie is one of our changing exhibits, Aquarist, and it is part of her job to take care of our jellies here at the New England Aquarium. Now, the New England Aquarium started growing jellies in the early 80s. So when the aquarium was built, it wasn't originally built for jellyfish. So we have tucked our jellies in pretty much all over the building. So Julie gets to run all over the aquarium taking care of jellyfish today. And she has generously agreed to give us a tour of some of those spaces. So I think today we're gonna start out in our jelly culture room. We'll talk a little bit more about what that means. But Julie, should we show them inside?
Yeah, let's go.
Awesome, after you. So for those of you who have been watching Facebook Live since way back before quarantine happened, you might recognize this room. This is the room that we talked to Chris, another one of our Jellies Aquarist, right actually behind where I'm standing now. So maybe, Julie, you can start off by telling us a little bit about what this room is used for.
Sure. So this is our jelly culture room. So in this room is where we keep all of our jellyfish cultures, as well as where we grow them up behind the scenes to one day be able to put them on exhibit.
Julie, can you explain to us maybe what a culture is?
Sure, so behind the scenes here, we have a bunch of dishes that are full of polyps, jelly polyps. And from those polyps is where we get all of the jellies that you see swimming around in these tanks, both in this room behind the scenes and also on exhibit.
So for those of you that might not be familiar, a polyp is another name for a baby jelly. Jellies do not look like this when they are small. In fact, they look more like a sea anemone, and that is called a polyp. This phase that you're seeing behind me here, this is the medusa, but this is only what they look like as adults. So Julie, do you think maybe you can show us what a baby jellyfish or a jelly polyp looks like?
Sure. So over here, we have some polyps of egg yolk jellies. So if you look closely, you can see that these polyps are attached to the substrate, which is just a hard surface. So in the ocean, a type of substrate they may attach to could be a rock, for example. And when those polyps are ready to start to create jellies, what will happen is they'll sort of segment themselves into this chain of segments. And each one of those segments will pop off of the polyp. And that stage of the life cycle is what we call an ephyra. So an ephyra is basically just a juvenile stage of what you would see or consider an adult jelly. So once those ephyrae grow a little bit bigger, they sort of start to look more and more like their adult form. So you can see actually behind me in this pseudocrysal tank here that we have some very small egg yolk jellies. And then if you look at the tank next to them, you can see even bigger egg yolk jellies. And this is closer to what they would look like when they're full grown. And sometimes in the ocean, egg yolk jellies can actually grow as big as a soccer ball.
Very cool. So, Julie, what exactly does it take to get our jellies here at the aquarium from these little tiny polyps all the way up to the adult medusa jellyfish that you're seeing next to me?
So it's a little bit of a process, but like I said, once those polyps start to release ephyrae, we'll collect those ephyrae, we'll put them into what we call a pal pen where we have water flowing through it to keep them suspended in the water column. We feed them brine shrimp, which are basically teeny tiny crustaceans that sort of swim around in the water column as well. And those ephyrae will catch them and eat them and grow bigger and bigger. And then once they're a little bit bigger, that's when we'll transfer them over into a bigger tank where there's some nice water flow to kind of keep them suspended. And they just keep growing that way.
Awesome. So you kind of hinted at this a little bit already, but do jellyfish have any specific care needs? Like, are there any special things that only jellyfish need or jellyfish need in particular?
Yep, so like I said, water flow is very, very important for taking care of jellies. They can't just sort of be settling at the bottom or up against the sides of a tank. They need to be suspended. So you can take a look at these pseudocrysals. They have a rounded bottom, which kind of keeps this nice circular flow, where some of them might kind of be held in the middle or around the edges here, but not settled to the bottom. Another thing that's important to consider when taking care of jellies is bubbles. So bubbles are actually very bad for jellies. So in your home aquarium, for example, you might have an air stick that kind of keeps the oxygen levels high in the water. But if a bubble got trapped inside the bell of a jelly, it could actually perforate the bell, which is bad for them. So no bubbles in a jelly tank. And then we just try to make sure that we're giving them a nice enriched diet. So we feed the brine shrimp that we feed them with some good nutrition so that they can grow into these large adult jellies that you see here.
Awesome. So Julie, how many species of jelly would you say we have here at the aquarium? And is it your job to care for all of the jellyfish at the aquarium?
Okay, so we probably have somewhere around 20 to 25 different species if you include all of the cultures that we have of polyps. And I do take care of the cultures and the jellies here, but I also do that with a team of people. So it's not just me.
That's good news. Julie can't be here 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, taking care of all of our jellies. She's got some help, well, just a little bit. Mm-hmm. Now, is this the only space in... We did already kind of give it away a little bit, but is this the only space in the aquarium where we are growing jellies?
It is not. We have a couple of other spaces behind the scenes where we keep some jellies.
Should we show them maybe one more jelly room?
Yeah, let's go.
Awesome. So we are actually behind the scenes in our temperate gallery right now, and you wouldn't know it from looking around, but we are just down the hall from the aquarium's cafe. So seems appropriate for jellies, right? Awesome. Now, Julie, maybe we should start off, what's different about this room? Are there different jellyfish species in here? Like, what's going on?
Yeah, so we do have a couple different species of jellies down here than we did from upstairs. Over here, we have some moon jellyfish in this tank right here. And those are probably the most common species that people can recognize. So we have a lot of them. And we use them for a lot of different things, as a matter of fact. So we'll use moon jellies, one, for food for other jellies, other species of jellies. So a lot of the nettles that we have are what we call medusavores. And so they actually have to eat other species of jellies to be able to grow. So that's one thing that we'll use them for. We have some on exhibit occasionally. We have jelly tubes. So we'll put some of the moons into these jelly tubes that we have our education staff hold a flashlight up to, and they'll take them out into the public space so that they can really take a good look at these jellies up close. And then sometimes we also send our jellies to other institutions as well.
Very cool. Now, there looks to be a very cool holding tank behind you. Julie, what is going on with all the lights and stuff back there?
So this is another species of jellies that we have in here, and they're called Cassiopeia, or upside down jellies. And they're actually a very interesting species. So they are not a type of jelly that sort of swims in the water column, as I was saying before. So they're an exception to that rule there. And they are essentially just upside down on the sand or the bottom of the ocean or lagoon where they are living, and they live in very shallow lagoon or mangrove waters. So a cool thing about Cassiopeia are they have this photosynthetic algae that lives inside their tissues, and they sort of have a symbiotic relationship with this algae, which means that both the algae and the jelly benefit from this relationship. So the jelly will give this algae sort of a place to live, and this algae will produce energy for the jelly as well. So that's why we have all these lights over here over this sort of a little sea table here that we have going. So, yeah.
And if that is sounding familiar to you, there's a reason for that. If you remember our Facebook Live video with our aquarist Christina downstairs in our mangrove exhibit, those are the same upside down jellies that Christina was talking about when we were referencing some of the other cool animals that live in that tank. So here you go. Here's the behind the scenes peek at the upside down jellies. All right, Julie, I gotta ask, what would you say is probably the most challenging part of caring for jellyfish?
Good question. So as you've seen, there are a lot of different species of jellies, and they all have a little bit different requirements to be able to keep them healthy. And so keeping that straight and making sure that we're meeting all those requirements for each different species is pretty challenging.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense. Over 20 different species you keep track of with slightly different needs. That's a lot to keep in your brain. So that makes perfect sense. And the question I have to ask, because everybody's going to want to know, as a jellies aquarist, have you ever been stung by a jellyfish?
Oh, yeah. Yes, I have.
Does it hurt?
Yeah. It sure does.
Awesome. Well, Julie, thank you so much for giving us a glimpse behind the scenes at our jellyfish here. I bet you would never know it by looking at our jellies exhibits, just how many species and how much hard work goes into getting those beautiful animals onto exhibit. So next time you visit us here at the aquarium, make sure that you check out our jellies on the second floor in our temperate gallery and appreciate all the hard work of folks like Julie. If you have questions today about jellies, about what Julie does here at the aquarium, about anything you've seen, put them in the comments. We would be happy to answer them for you. And we hope that you tune in again soon. Thanks, friends.